Welcome, students.
So we have seen how Jane Eyre by Charlotte Bronte is one of the most romantic and most distressful story of all times. It was a story about a poor orphan girl who is ill-treated by her relatives and is forced to go away to a charity school where her experiences are no better than at home. And she goes to Thornfield to teach a young girl. She meets the owner of Thornfield, falls in love with her, and discovers that there is a dark secret about him. This story continues into the imagination of the reader today as much as it had done in the mind of the reader of Charlotte Bronte's own time. Important themes which are discussed in Jane Eyre is our next discussion. Jane Eyre is first of all a story, a romantic story. So love and passion are the main themes that are discussed in this novel. The fact that Jane Eyre is an orphan, she is not loved by anybody. The relatives that she stays with do not want her, consider her as a burden, and therefore Jane must constantly look for acceptance and love and appreciation in every person that she meets with is the mainstay of the story. So when once she finds Bessie, that is love enough for her, but then she finds no acceptance in Mrs. Fairfax, in Helen Burns, but it is not enough. Then she finds Mr. Rochester's love for her. Once again, Rochester's love lets her down because she finds out that Rochester is about to commit a bigamy, and this disappointing event leads her to move out of the house which she had thought is going to be her future home, and she moves to yet another stage of her life where she finds relatives, real blood relatives in the rivers, and once again she has found almost what she has always wanted to attain, and that is some sort of an acceptance for a person who has grown up without parents, someone who has grown up in a house, in a society which has never ready to give her her due, although she is an extremely talented, extremely intelligent woman. Now, having found this love of the rivers, who are her relatives, she feels emotionally strengthened. She feels an inner strength which comes to her, and that inner strength becomes a catalyst in putting her back to a past where she can go back to Rochester once again and is able to make a life with Rochester. Only when she has developed a confidence in the fact that her family and love has made her a more secured human being. This is what we can say the first and most important theme. The other theme which is of importance is the Christianity. Now, in the novel, we find three different kinds of models of Christianity described. One model of Christianity through Helen Burns. Second model of Christianity through Mr. Brocklehurst. And the third one through St. John Rivers. And we find that Brocklehurst's evangelism or Christianity that he proposes is all about hypocrisy. He is only interested in making money for his own family. If we come to Helen Burns, a kind of Christianity, it is about forgiveness, it's about tolerating all kinds of injustice which is being done to her. And when we come to St. John's kind of Christianity, we find that he is pious to an extent where he cuts out all kinds of passion, emotion, everything out of his life. It is just a contract. And this kind of Christianity is also not acceptable just as much as Brocklehurst's and Helen Burns' Christianity is not acceptable to Jane. Jane finds her own Christianity. This Christianity makes her turn to God for every little help in life. And she always feels that God is there to guide her. But it is a Christianity which she finds and the author projects as the middle path of Christianity, which is one that gives respect to a human being as a human being. We know class prejudice actually was a very much burning issue in Victorian England. Class was very important to the English society. They had a very complicated social structure, and governess's role was very new in this social structure. Women had not gone out to work till a century back. And then suddenly there were women who were working as governesses in the aristocratic homes. These women knew exactly what the aristocratic way of lifestyle is, their mode of education is, their culture in life is, but they did not belong to the aristocracy. This created a very interesting new development in the society, and it put a lot of women who obviously are from a very poverty-stricken background, an unfortunate background. It could be various reasons. It could be because of the parental demand. It could be because their own poverty or for loss of wealth that they are forced to take up these work as governess. But having once taken up the work of governess, they go to live in aristocratic household. And this creates a lot of hassle in the social structure. Now, Jane is a poor orphan. She has repeatedly been insulted because of her poverty. Her relatives in childhood consider her a burden. They try to send her away to a charity school. In the charity school also, she is given no appreciation, no recognition of her immense intelligence, simply because she is a burden on the state exchequer. Lastly, when she moves to Thornfield as a governess, she meets up with the same kind of insult. Why? Because there are aristocratic characters like Mrs. Ingram who believe that because she is a governess, she is living as a dependent in a household of the aristocratic Mr. Rochester, she is also a burden on the society. So this kind of a social distinction about a woman who was born or has been brought up in a unfortunate circumstances is always there. Jane denies very strongly that her poverty never affects her. But nevertheless, the rise out of the poverty that she has, the miraculously inheriting money, £20,000 from her uncle, makes a difference in her situation. So much so that having inherited the money, having taken possession of the money and distributed, shared it among all the Rivers brothers and sisters, she still manages to feel confident enough to get back to Mr. Rochester and marry him, because now she feels that she is no longer socially inferior to Mr. Rochester, and she can now meet him at his level and also be at par wealth-wise to Mr. Rochester. Victorian society was very, very class conscious, but more than class consciousness, at this point in time, there was a lot of gender consciousness. Why was this gender consciousness? Gender consciousness was simply because women were not expected to move out of a certain role that had been assigned to them by the society so far. And working as tutors in schools, working as governesses in some people's house, women were breaking this mold. And these were educated women. They were not expected to break the mold. And therefore, it was more important that they should be brought under some kind of a subjugation. There is an attempt to subjugate Jane. Three men, three antagonists in her life. The first antagonist is Mr. Brocklehurst, who owns a school, and therefore he tries to admonish her for her behavior. He tries to subjugate her. Second, it happens with Mr. Rochester. Mr. Rochester, who is her employer, tries to subjugate her to his own demands, requirements, by even suggesting that she lives in sin with him. But in the end also we find Senjin, who's as a cousin was so very accommodating, was allowing to Jane to find her relative past connections, helping her to acquire the money which has been left behind for her by her dead uncle, suddenly turns differently as soon as Jane refuses his marriage proposal. He wants Jane to be submissive. He wants Jane to accept her role as a wife of a missionary and come to India for the future. These three men are antagonists for Jane. And Jane's quest for independence, for self-knowledge, is to when she manages to break away from all these. Brocklehurst, she leaves behind. Senjin, she leaves behind. And Rochester, she meets at an equal footing. So when that happens, Jane's entire quest for her personality has taken place. Jane Eyre is a novel which is replete with scenes about dreams that Jane has, some premonition of some danger which is going to happen, some clairvoyant visions which she might be experiencing. There are voices that she hears. It starts from the Red Room incident, happens many times repeatedly in Jane's life, and she is almost able to be directed towards her life's destined goal by all these mystical voices that she hears. There is a funny incident even as far as the supernatural is concerned. We find that Mr. Rochester dresses up like a gypsy and he comes to read Jane's future. It's almost as if he is able to peer into Jane's mind and is able to recreate what is there, what is passing through her mind's eye. And in the end, when Rochester and Jane are brought together in the novel, reaching its culmination, we find it's once again the help of the supernatural which is required to unite them. At the moment when Jane decides that she is going to accept Senjin's offer, she is prompted by an inner voice. She likes to describe it as an inner voice. It's a voice of nature, almost that nature which wants Rochester and Jane to get together and not Jane marrying someone else, prompting her that there is Rochester and this is the moment to get back to Rochester, and that is where her future lies. Every point in her life, Jane almost experiences this kind of a prompting by a power which is larger than the ethereal power, the earthly powers, to guide her towards her culmination of her destiny. And even when she puts an advertisement in the newspaper for a new job, she hears a voice which tells her to do that. In fact, Rochester, when he first meets Jane in the moor, that first experience of the two protagonists meeting, we find that later on Rochester describes that he thinks that she had bewitched and cast a spell on Rochester's dog and Rochester's horse. So it is almost that there is a supernatural element which is constantly built. The author harks back on the gothic novels of the past to build up this kind of a gothic element in the novel, probably also to make the novel mystery novel. Now the mystery also lies in the fact that there is about Rochester's past something which is dark, which is secret. A Barthamason is fact which is not known to anyone. Nobody in the house also ever tells Jane about Bartha's existence. But Bartha is also an interesting character because she has lived a normal life of a young girl, got married to Rochester, and now she's considered to be a woman. And she comes down and she almost uncannily is aware of what is going to happen. And when she tears up the veil that Jane is supposed to wear on her wedding day, it is almost giving a supernatural joining hand with a human element to give a warning to Jane not to go forward with an incident which might not prove to be pleasant in for her life. This, and as well as the end of the novel, where after discovering that Thornfield has been burnt down, when she finds Ferndale and she sees from a distance Rochester, she realized that she had one day back heard a frantic call from Rochester, like in a psychic sympathy between two kindred souls. And this element of supernatural makes the reading of the novel very, very interesting over the ages to all the readers. Let us take Jane Eyre and Bartha Mason, the two main women characters who have constantly been analyzed and studied by critics all over the world. One is Jane. Now, Jane is a artistic person, is a sensitive young woman. She is passionate. She meets with fierce opposition from day one of the book. First, it is Mrs. Reed, who will not accept her in the charmed circle of her children because she does not behave like children. And what is the behavior that is expected of Jane at this point? She is expected to behave with a lot of gratitude towards everyone in Reed's family. And she in order to get financial and emotional succor, she depends on the Reeds. But Jane has an inferior position. And at every point in life, whether it is relatives, or it is in the Lowood School, or it is in Thornton, this identity that she is coming from a inferior social circle is constantly drilled into her. And it stays with Jane. Jane is unable to overcome this sort of an inferiority in position in the life until she finds a redemption in finding, first of all, relatives who want her for herself, Senjin and his two sisters, and also in the fact that she has inherited some money from her uncle. Therefore, we can see that the author actually is criticizing the Victorian society. Now, the entire character of Jane Eyre is like an attempt by the author to show the protest, break through the barrier, and establish a kind of a situation where an ideal balance between Rochester and Jane. Now, next character is Bartha Mason. It is an amazing study Bartha Mason's character presents to us. Bartha Mason is a beautiful woman who was from a prominent West Indian family. She had married Rochester because the families wanted to bring the wealth of the two families together. And she suffers from hereditary insanity. But before she falls a prey to this hereditary insanity, it is said that Bartha had led promiscuous life. Now, therefore, Bartha does not conform to the social demand of the Victorian age. So the Victorian age has a gender role for every woman to play. Bartha is not able to play that role. The minute she steps out of with her promiscuity, with the fact that she is extremely beautiful in the bargain, she has to be declared insane. And she is locked away. She is put away in the attic of the house so that she does not escape and harm other people in the society. Bartha deserves our sympathy because she is in prison. And it is only in Bartha's death that Rochester and Jane can come together. Therefore, we know almost as a preconceived fact that Bartha will have to die. She has transgressed Victorian boundaries of the gender. Therefore, she will have to be put aside. And it is Bartha's character is a commentary by the author on the prevalent condition of Victorian marriages, where marriages were conducted not because two people fell in love and wanted to be with each other, but because two families wanted to bring all the advantages of their individual families together. And this is something Charlotte Bronte put up as a criticism. She never agreed that this sort of a marriage is to be encouraged or to be praised. Because when she refuses Senjin, or when she rationalizes Senjin's proposal, she has already said in her own mind, Jane has already said, expressing the author's view, that a cold marriage or without passion, which has been brought together by logic of what is necessary, is not a marriage at all for a person like Jane. Next, we are going to discuss the important male protagonists of the novel. One is Edward Rochester, and the other is John Rivers. Now, owner of Thornfield Manor, employer of Jane, and also Jane's lover, subsequently Jane's husband, is Rochester. Edward Rochester is a Byronic character. He is passionate character. He matches up to Jane in every sense of the word. But he has a very dark past. He appeals to Jane, and Jane appeals to him at an intellectual plane, at a sensual plane. But he has been deceived in past by Bartha's passion. Adderley, he says, is self-confessed could have been his own daughter out of wedlock. But having gone through these kinds of promiscuity, Rochester must change himself. And that change not only is through the change of attitude towards Jane, but it has also got to be a purgation which is visible. And Rochester is also important to Jane because he has provided Jane for the first time with the unconditional kind of love that she has been looking hitherto in her life. She has not found it in her paternal family. She failed to find it in Helen Burns. Mrs. Fairfax's love or Bessie's love is not never an adequate compensation. It is only when she finds Rochester in her life, she is able to gain for the first time a sense of family, which she has been looking since the death of her parents. One other thing that worth mentioning here is that Rochester may be a little superior to Jane in many ways. His experiences are more varied. He is wealthier than Jane. His intellectual superiority is of worldly knowledge is more than Jane. But somewhere he has also an inferiority. In moral conduct, he falls short of Jane. In not being able to discuss with Jane honestly that he is going to commit a bigamy by marrying Jane because his first wife is still alive is something which reduces Rochester one notch below in the morality. Moving to the next male protagonist, that is Senjin. Senjin is also an evangelist, clergyman who believes in taking the words of Christ to every part of the world. To that extent, he has decided to join as a missionary to go to India. But he responds to the call of the God. He cannot respond to anyone else. Rosamond is deeply in love with Senjin. But Senjin will not respond to that love because she thinks that Rosamond is not the right kind of wife for a clergyman. For him, since he has taken a cold decision of being a clergyman in India, nothing else should hinder or come into the way of what he has decided to do. He is almost like a Greek statue, a marble statue which has no life. And when he proposes to Jane, the reader actually shudders to think what will happen if passionate Jane accepts cold character like Senjin for marriage. What kind of a life would Jane be looking at if Senjin is her husband? But in terms of the two characters, Rochester and Senjin, there have been many critics who have called them fire and ice. And fire and ice is a significant symbolism in this particular novel. And lack of passion of Senjin, which makes him cold, ice cold, and the passion of Rochester, which makes him like a fire, burning fire, are constantly contrasted by the author. And it is the joy would come to the protagonist only when she matches her own fire with fire and not when she douses all her passion by the ice coldness that Senjin represents in life. And with that, we have all wrapped up the whole lesson of Jane Eyre by Charlotte Bronte. And thank you very much for being here. I hope it has been a very, very informative lesson for you.